You see her every tear. You know how much we long for the day when you're going to make everything right. We so look forward to that time where there is no more sighing, crying, tears. We thank you that even in the midst of sometimes when we sorrow, we can rejoice because we've been set free in Jesus Christ. Thank you that we have a hope that goes beyond this life. Thank you that this is not all there is. Thank you that our stumbling and bumbling around here doesn't end in nothingness, but it ends in glory. Lord Jesus, you experienced deep sorrows. You were a man of sorrows. You were acquainted with grief. You bore our burdens on Calvary, and that included our sorrows as well as our sins. And so you're a good comforter, and you have sent us your Holy Spirit as a comforter that dwells within those who believe. And so, Father, we ask for your good comfort this holiday season as we turn our eyes to your Son, Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that you'd help us to be a blessing, an encouragement, and a comfort to those around us. Help us to be alert to people who might put a smile on their face, but on the inside, they're quietly in sorrow. May we be alert. May we have the right words of encouragement and strength, or no words at all, just our presence to be beside them. And now, Father, we invite you to take control of our hearts and minds and of this moment tonight. We pray that you would magnify your Son, Lord Jesus Christ, that you would lift our vision away from ourselves and unto Christ, that you would fill my father-in-law, Dan Sherman, with your Holy Spirit, those who have a part in this service tonight, that you would fill them with your Holy Spirit, and those who are here as participants, more that you would fill them with your Spirit. And if there is someone here that doesn't know Jesus, give them the ultimate answer in Christ and save them. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to welcome you to the Community Remembrance Service. It's good to see everyone here tonight. This is not a somber event. It's a time of reflection, though, and I'm so glad to see you here. I'm reminded of Job and his suffering, and in Job chapter 23, it says this, as he reflects on the extreme pain that he's in, the deep valley that he's in. Behold, I go forward, but he is not there. And backward, but I do not perceive him. On the left hand, when he is working, I do not behold him. He turns to the right hand, but I do not see him. But he knows the way that I take. And when he has tried me, I shall come out as gold. This is Job opining that he's hurting so deeply. He's in such sorrow and such grief and such physical pain, relational loss, that he says that he can't even sense the presence of God. It is not unspiritual to have moments where you say, God, where are you? I go forward, he's not there. Backward, I don't perceive him. On the left, he's working. I don't behold him. I turn to the right, you don't see him. But he sees me. He knows the way that I take. And when he has tried me, I shall come out as gold. But my prayer for you tonight, for us, is that this will be part of God's work in your life through Christ, through his word, through his Spirit. A refining moment that helps to polish us so that we will come forth as gold on that great day when Jesus calls us to himself. And for Job, okay was not in his vocabulary or any Hebraic equivalent. Tonight, it's okay to remember, smile, and receive encouragement. And it's even okay to shed a tear. I am so excited that my father-in-law is here tonight, my mother-in-law, and Dan Sherman, a hero of mine. He's 30 years ahead of me, and I'm following in his footsteps. But he was my first pastor. Not that I didn't grow up in the church, but once I actually got saved, he was my first pastor. And I learned and grew under him. And so to periodically have that opportunity for Dan to be in this pulpit and preach to us here is a special treat for me. But I also think that, Dan, you are exceptionally qualified, not just with years and decades of experience in ministry, but having gone through the severe and unexpected loss of your son here. When he was so young, I think that also particularly qualifies you for helping us in a moment like tonight. So thank you for being here. I invite Ryan. In the revelation from Christ received by John in the 21st chapter, "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. The former things have passed away.' And he who was seated on the throne said, 'Behold, I am making all things new.'" I'm
gone from my sight. I'm standing upon the seashore, a ship at my side spreads her white sails to the moving breeze and starts for the blue ocean. She is an object of beauty and strength. I stand and watch her until at length she hangs like a speck of white cloud, just where the sea and sky come to mingle with each other. Then someone at my side says, "There, she is gone." Gone? Gone where? Gone from my side, that is all. She is just as large in mast, hull, and spar as she was when she left my side, and she is just as able to bear her load and living freight to her destined port. Her diminished size is in me, not in her. And just at the moment when someone says, "There, she is gone," there are other eyes watching her coming, and other voices ready to take up the glad shout, "Here she comes," and that is her.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'd like to ask the question, how many here tonight have lost a loved one in the last 3 years? Raise your hand. Okay. The last 2 years. The last year. The last 6 months. I didn't say the last month. Does Jesus care? Well, we're going to find out if Jesus cares. Reading from Luke chapter 4, beginning with verse 18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives and the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised. Those verses cover us all. Jesus came to heal the brokenhearted. You know how Jesus heals the brokenhearted? Through the gospel. Through the gospel. I'm so thankful that someone took the time to share the gospel with me, to show me the way of salvation, to show me that I could have the assurance of being with Jesus throughout all eternity. I'll be eternally grateful for Earl Kearney, the man who knocked on my door and told me about Jesus. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we know that thou art the great comforter. And Father, there are those here tonight that need to feel your loving embrace. They need to know that you care. Father, help them to see that they can cast all their care upon you. You care for them. Father, I pray that these next few moments together would be a challenge and a blessing to each of our hearts. Father, it's been my privilege to lead multitudes to the threshold and see them cross over and to enter into the arms of Jesus. Father, I pray now that you bless. For I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Does Jesus care? Sooner or later, death will come knocking at your door. This unwelcome visitor cannot be barred entry. Death is our most feared and dreaded enemy. Every day he visits thousands of doors. I've had to answer that door. The door of that grisly caller twice in my life so far. We were expecting our first child. At 8 months, he was stillborn. We never got to hold him in our arms. And then your pastor mentioned the death of our son, Eric. Now, we're all going to have to meet this unwelcome guest at some time in our life, unless Jesus comes. I can honestly say I have never asked why. If anyone had reason to ask why, it certainly would have been Joe, and I was hoping James wouldn't trample on me here. But imagine his feelings when he heard these words. You've lost your livestock. They've been stolen. Your sheep and camels have been destroyed. Your employees have been murdered. And Joe, one more thing. Your children were crushed in a freak windstorm. They're dead. They're dead, my friend. All 10 of them. That actually happened to Joe. He got the news in a span of 5 minutes. Grief-stricken, yes. Stunned, surely he was. Confused, reeling, stinging, standing beside 10 fresh graves. At a total loss to explain even one tragedy, to say nothing of 5, it was naked, raw agony. The heavens were silent, but not once did Job ask why. No single truth removes the need to ask why than this, or this one. God is too kind to do anything cruel. He's too wise to make a mistake, and he's too deep to explain himself. Does Jesus care? Does Jesus care when my heart is paying too deeply for mirth and song, as the burden is pressed and the cares distress, and the way grows weary and long? Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched by my grief. When the days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares. Does Jesus care when I am trying to fail to resist some temptation strong? But for my deep grief, there's no relief, though my tears flow all my heart. Oh yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched by my grief. When the days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares. Does Jesus care when I have said goodbye to the dearest on earth to me? And my sorry heart aches till it nearly breaks. Is it aught to him? Does he care? Oh, yes, he cares. I know he cares. His heart is touched by my grief. When the days are weary, the long nights dreary, I know my Savior cares. So what are we to do when we've said goodbye to our dearest on earth? First of all, God wants us to grieve. God wants us to grieve. He's given us tear ducts that we might weep. The five stages of grief are, first of all, is denial. This didn't happen. It can't be happening. I don't understand. And then we go to anger. We become angry at the one, baby, who's left us. We become angry with God. And then we stop bargaining. Can't bargain with God. And then we go to depression. We become depressed. And then finally we get to that stage of acceptance. If you're grieving here tonight, you're going to find yourself in one of those stages. Some helpful hints to those who are grieving tonight. First of all, scale back your obligations. Take time to grieve. I've dealt with people who put it off and put it off and put it off. And 6 months down the road, bang, their whole life falls apart. Because it didn't take time to grieve. And then cry it out. Cry it out. Cry it out. After I performed my son's funeral, I went home and I laid on that bed and I cried. And I cried. And I continued to cry. And I cried for days. Then you want to avoid self-medication. Stay away from sleeping pills. The uppers, the downers. Sometimes doctor-prescribed medication may help. And then find a good Christian support group. Do you have one here? There you go. Stop one. I would not recommend Compassionate Friends. Right after our son died, we were asked to go to a group called Compassionate Friends. Oh, they were so glad to see us. They welcomed us. And then there may have been 40 or 50 people in the room, and they were going around, and people were telling about the loss of their child. Some were weeping and carrying on, and then they came to us, and we told them how we were handling our grief, how that we knew our son was in heaven with the Lord Jesus Christ, and he was bringing comfort to our hearts. They didn't get too excited about that. In fact, they never invited us back. But you know some of the people that were there. When they told how long they'd been grieving, some 35 years. There's something wrong, folks, when it's carrying on for 35 years. Others, 20 years. And they were talking about like it was within the last week. And then make no major decisions for at least 6 months. That's tremendous advice. Now, in the grieving process, you need to pour your heart out to God. Vent your feelings. God understands your feelings. He knows those feelings of anger, the numbness, the abandonment, the helplessness. He knows of the empty chair. He knows of the silent voice that you'll never hear again. The gentle touch, the warm embrace, that daily companion now gone. God understands that. Remember, Jesus came to heal the brokenhearted. Jesus alone can fill the void that you're experiencing. No one understands. understands like Jesus. He's a friend beyond compare. Meet him at the throne of mercy. He's waiting for you there. No one understands like Jesus. When the days are dark and grim, no one is so near. So, dear Jesus, cast your every care on him. Don't put a time limit on your grieving. I would suggest 25 years. Healing will come and life will return to normalcy. Yes, God wants you to grieve. There is no set formula for grieving. When I first went to work with hospice, they didn't have a grief counselor. So guess who ended up being the grief counselor? Me. And they said, we don't want you to talk about Jesus. You don't want me to talk about Jesus, you want me to be the grief counselor. Guess what, folks? I talked about Jesus. The second thing God wants you to do is believe. He wants you to grieve, but he wants you to believe. That whatsoever, or whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That word perish means to be separated from God for all eternity. And that comes at the second death. For all those who do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, they will face the second death and will be separated from God for all eternity. The Philippian jailer rushed in and asked Paul, what must I do to be saved? Paul said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. What do you believe? What is your belief that motivates you tonight? Is there evidence in your activities that you believe in God? We only believe that which motivates us. The Bible tells us what to believe. It gives us three basic beliefs on which all biblical truths rest. We're to believe that God exists. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. The Bible said that we're to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is his commandment, that we believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and love one another as he gave commandment, 1 John 3, verse 23. And then we're to believe the gospel. The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe the gospel. Now, what is the gospel that we're to believe? That Jesus died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried and he was raised again the third day according to the scriptures. I'm glad that God loved me enough to send his son, the Lord Jesus Christ, to die on the cross, to pay my sin debt. Oh, how I love to tell the story, to be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. And I've been doing that for almost 58 years, telling people about Jesus and his love. Every year around this time, my heart goes back, my mind goes back to that day when I heard those chilling words, those frightening words, Dan, come quick, there's something wrong with Eric. I ran to the living room, just 20 feet from where I was sitting. Allie, the pastor's wife, had been playing with her brother, and they just ran through the den into the living room. Allie called her mom and said, Eric is making a funny noise. And my wife says, I'll stop him, I'll go and tickle him. Instead, She yelled those terrifying words. I got up, ran to Eric. He had already turned blue. I thought maybe he had been choking, so I pressed his chest and his abdomen, releasing any fluid that might have been trapped in his throat. I continued CPR. EMT squad arrived within 5 minutes. They worked for an hour and a half, restoring his heartbeat. He was then transported to Mass General Hospital. My wife and I were accompanied by deacons from my church and some friends. We kept vigil all night long. We were praying. We were getting hourly updates. And they would come in and say, his heart is getting weaker, getting weaker, getting weaker. And then at 7 o'clock in the morning, they told us Eric had passed away. But we knew where he was. And then we were asked to meet with the doctors and the nurses who had attended Eric through the night. They said they wanted to console us. We explained to them that we'd be all right. We knew that our son knew the Lord Jesus Christ. We knew that we would see him again. And then we gave them our testimony. They responded. We've never seen anyone respond like this. We wanted to meet with you in order to help you, and you've done more for us than we could ever do for you. One doctor stopped us after the meeting and he said, tell me more about your faith. He said, I've never heard anything like this in all my life. Yes, Jesus cares. And then thirdly, God wants you to receive. But as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the children of God, even to them that believed on his name. John 1:12. The verse that I shared earlier, John 3:16, says, for God so loved the world that he gave. Jesus is God's love gift to us. But we must personally receive it. Now, I didn't seek a job with hospice, but I got a phone call asking me if I would come in for an interview. They were needing a chaplain. I think at that time there were about 12. Am I boss to be, she said, what can you do to help our patients? And I said, I can tell them about receiving God's love gift to them and how they can know where they're going to spend eternity. She said, what if they're Roman Catholic? I said, if they ask me to be their chaplain, they're going to hear about Jesus. And then she ran the gamut of every religion on the face of the earth, and I gave her the same response. She thanked me. My wife said, well, how did it go? And I told her what I said, and she said, you're not going to get that job. I said, I don't care. I said, I didn't apply for it anyway. I just went for the interview. 2 weeks later, they said, you ready to go to work? 2 weeks before our son Eric died. And he died 2 days before Christmas. But he came forward in church and he said, I see you now. What did he say? You remember? What did he say? He began to say, he said, Daddy, I want God to use me. I was thrilled. Well, maybe he's going to be a preacher. Maybe he's going to be a missionary. I sure didn't think that God was going to use him through his death. To fulfill Eric's desire to be used of God, we began the Big E camp. We officially called my son Big E And so naturally we gave that name to the church, to the camp. A day camp for boys and girls from age 5 to 12. We began camp that first day with 6 children. 6. 7 years later, we were running 360 children a day. And you know, we saw hundreds of boys and girls come to know Jesus. God was using Eric. And here's an amazing thing. In 7 years of working with hundreds of boys and girls, riding ponies, playing all kinds of games, doing everything under the sun, we never even had to use one band-aid. That is an amazing thing. One little boy particularly stood out. I took a special interest in him. Out of the hundreds of boys and girls we worked with, Nicky Marka is the only one that I ever invited to my home to spend the day. It was just before Christmas. I did a lot of crafts back in those days, and we made a gift for his mom. I think it was his love and enthusiasm for the Big Eight camp that really drew me to him. He didn't look anything like my son, but oh, how he loved the Big Eight camp. It was in September that Nicky was in the first grade. His uncle called me one afternoon and said, "Pastor, can you visit my sister and husband right away?" He went on to say that little Nicky had been watching other children play a soccer game on the school playground. Somehow they hit the goal post, knocking the goal over. It was steel goal post, hitting little Nicky in the head, killing him instantly. He was their only child. When I arrived at the home, Bobby and Tom Marcotte were sitting on a sofa in the living room. People were in line passing before the couple, expressing their condolences. 2 Roman Catholic priests stood before them, placed a hand on their shoulder, nodded once or twice, and passed on, and remained in line, circling the room. When I got before Bobby and Tom, I dropped on my knees. And I said, "Bobby and Tom, don't you want to see Nicky again?" And they were just sobbing. Said, "Oh yes." I opened my Bible and shared Jesus with them. They prayed and receive the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. They then told me that every day when Nicky came home from the Big E camp, little Nicky is 5 years old, said, "Mommy and Daddy, you need to get Jesus in your heart." He said, "So you can go to heaven with me." You know what the gospel did for them? It brought all the peace in the world. If you had to ask Tom and Bobby if Jesus cares, what do you think they would say?
Yeah. Yes.
They would say, "Oh yes, he cares. He cares that much." That's how much Jesus cared for you. If you're here today and you're grieving and you've never received Jesus as your Savior, you need Him. That's why He came. He came to preach the gospel, to heal the brokenhearted. And the way to be healed is through the gospel. There is no other healing. No other healing. I'm out of time, I think. Am I out of time?
No.
All right, I want to give just one more illustration. When I went to work in hospice, and I told you what I was going to tell the people, I'm going to tell them about Jesus. And right, maybe a little time before I was getting ready to retire, I had one man, he was up in his 90s. And he said, I want you to come and visit me on Friday. He said, I've got to get some things straightened out. Now, his daughter was married to a pastor of a large church, Southern Baptist Church, in Sumter, South Carolina. He had tried to witness to this man over and over and over again. So when I went to visit him, I said, what is it you need to get straightened out? He said, I know I don't have long to live, but I need to know where I'm going. Ooh. I led him to the Lord. That was on Friday. On Monday, he met his Savior. On the last day that I was employed, and they did this at the end of every month, they would take all the letters that they had received throughout the month from people who had lost loved ones during that time. The last one they came to, they opened it up, and this is what the boss that hired me read. It said, I want to thank hospice for the wonderful care they gave my dad. I want to thank the doctors, the nurses, the social workers, and the personal caregivers. But most of all, I want to thank Chaplain Dan Sherman for leading my dad to the Lord Jesus Christ. She said, I know I'm going to see him again in heaven. Now that, when we had the meetings, the doctors, the social workers, everybody is there. And it was just like, thank you, God. Thank you. That's your stamp of approval. You're here and you're grieving a loss. Tell it to Jesus. He cares. He heals. If you're here tonight for some other, and you have some other need, maybe you are fighting some temptation strong. Jesus cares. He heals. But he gives victory. If you're here without Jesus tonight, it's no mistake that you're here. You're here by divine appointment. And you know, it would be a great thing for you to receive Jesus tonight. Because if you receive Jesus tonight, Eric would still be being used. Because I told you his story. Daddy, I want God to use me. If you haven't ever received him, do that tonight. Imagine being in heaven, and we heard the voice of the verses read. A place where there's going to be no more tears, no more death, no more sorrow, no more pain. Former things will be passed away. That's what Jesus has done for us. That's how much Jesus cares.
Thank you. That's wonderful.
My faithful Father, enduring from your tender mercies like a river with no end. want you to let that sink in for a moment. I thank God upon every remembrance of you. He's writing people that can hear him, hear the words read to them. Maybe you have somebody that you've lost and you thank God upon every remembrance of them. I'm going to invite Cindy to come to the piano. And as she plays softly in the background, I'm going to invite you to join me to come to the Christmas tree in just a moment or two. And on this Christmas tree, you're going to find an ornament that you're going to take in honor of a loved one. And there's a verse on there, Psalm chapter 91, verse 4 says, "He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you shall take refuge." And it's a dove. It reminds you of comfort of the Holy Spirit, and also reminds you, honors and memory of the person that you love, but that you love lost. And as you come and take this ornament from the tree, I'm going to ask you to do something. Just say out their name. Just say the name of the person that you love, that you lost. And in doing so, just take a moment to honor them. It's real simple. You come to the tree. Remember the person as you take the ornament and you speak their name. And you go return to your seat. In a few moments, we'll have a closing prayer and then be dismissed. But I'm going to invite you to do that as Cindy plays.